some look back at the last 2 years' history. Indian equity markets continued to gain in 2019, but the returns weren't as stellar, nor the rally broad. Yash Upadhyaya is standing by with a closer look at the market performance this year and maybe compare it to some of the recent historical periods as well. Yash, what do you have for us today?
Morning, Neeraj. So it might not come as a surprise to you or for anyone that the last 2 years have been extremely difficult for the Indian markets. Yet in 2019, we are the Sensex and the Nifty both are likely to close in the green, which would make it four consecutive years of positive returns for the benchmark indices. And this is how the trend has been over the last 16 years. And this would mean that it would be the longest gaining streak for the benchmark indices since the Great Depression of 2007, when the index had gained for four consecutive years as well. And now it is obviously down to the fact that we've seen that market cap polarization driving the index higher, despite of the fact that we've had concerns from the follow-up of the NBFC crisis, which took place in the second half of last year. Then there has been concerns of the GDP slowing down, concerns on the global front with respect to North Korea and the nukes, as well as the US-China trade war. And yet, despite of that, we are seeing a fourth consecutive year of gains for the benchmark index. Yet, despite of that, less than half of the All India stocks have managed to give positive returns. So what we've done essentially over here is that we've taken a look at companies which have a market cap of over 1,000 crore rupees and are tracked by at least five analysts. The reason for doing so is to eliminate those penny stocks as well as companies which are very low on volumes and are very thinly traded, so that we get you the right subset. And out of those companies, out of the 404 companies, which is the universe of these factors, only 169 companies have managed to give positive returns, while 229 companies have given negative return so far this year. Not just that, over a third of the 169 companies, 58 to be precise, have given returns which are less than the benchmark index. So in this case, we are taking the Sensex as an example, and more than a third of these companies have given returns of less than 11.9% in this period. Just to look at how painful it has been in the broader markets, we look at another parameter, which is the number of stocks that have managed to double investor wealth so far this year. And there's an interesting trend over here. Okay, so first I'll start with 2018, where there was not a single stock with these two criteria which managed to double investor wealth. And there have been times in the past where that has happened. Take a look at 2011, where there were zero stocks, 2008, as well as 2001. But the next year after that has always been positive. Take a look at 2012, where 32 stocks managed to double investor wealth. Even the case of 2009, where 144 stocks managed to double investor wealth. But this is the first time that we are seeing two consecutive years of pain for the Indian markets. And exact same similarity has been seen right at the start of the year, start of the new century, when 2001 and 2002, there was the exact same series. So zero stocks being doubled in 2001 and only three stocks that managed to double investor wealth in 2002, and the next year has been positive. So if this trend is something to go by, maybe 2020 may be a positive year, but obviously that could be anyone's guess, you know, Neeraj.
Yeah, let's not try and guesstimate that, because you can never know. You might have three consecutive years of pain as well. But Yash, let's just take a look at 2019 and what are the stocks which have gained and what are the stocks which have lost out.
So it has been clearly financials which have dominated this list, Neeraj. I'll start first with Reliance Nippon, which has given outstanding returns in excess of 113% so far this year, as well as Aavas Financier and Credit Access Grameen, who have all gained anywhere between 109% to 113% so far this year. Reliance Nippon, again, it's down to the fact that only 2% of the Indian population invests in the Indian market. So the analysts see a huge growth potential from the underpenetrated market as well as its retail-focused business. Moving on to Credit Access or Aavas Financiers, that one's done well, and mainly on account of its focus on affordable housing segment, as well as its strong asset quality, which has been one of the key positives for the company, as well as presence in the less competitive segments and expansion into newer geographies. That is something that the analysts really like. For Credit Access Grameen, it has seen the analysts are positive of a strong growth opportunity in the microfinance lending business. It has had a consistent track record of execution, and its aggressive provisioning policies that has bulletproofed its P&L account from any of the discrepancies. An honorable mention to this list is HDFC AMC. We spoke about it yesterday, how the stock has managed to crash from its peak by almost over 10%, and that's the reason why it is very close to being above that mark. Obviously, it was above that mark just a few days back, but still at about 98.3% is within 2% of making it to that list. So probably by the end of the year, we might see HDFC AMC also feature in that list. But as of now, it stands at almost 98.3%. On the other hand, which are the companies which have been the biggest wealth destroyers? They include the likes of HEG, Vodafone, Idea, Indiabulls Housing Finance, all losing anywhere between 70 to 72%, as well as the likes of Yes Bank and Dish TV. HEG, it has been down to the weak product prices on account of the weak steel demand, as well as the lifting of the anti-dumping duty by the Indian government on the graphite electrode being imported from China, and the high needle coke prices, which has put pressure on their margins. Moving on, when it comes to Vodafone Idea, the biggest overhang for the stock was the Supreme Court ruling on the AGR issue, where the company is expected to pay in excess of almost 44,000 crores of dues to the government, which has raised concern over the company's ability to operate as a going concern. That apart, is declining subscriber base as well as ARPU downtrading that have been some of the biggest negatives as far as its operational performance is concerned as well. Indiabulls Housing, it has been the worsening group debt as well as the series of credit downgrades by the credit agencies. That has been a big negative for the company. Yes Bank, the high NPA book as well as its deteriorating asset quality, that has been a cause of concern for the company, as well as its inability to raise money, which has impaired the analyst's view on the stock. And lastly, when it comes to Dish TV, again, there have been concerns over high leverage and its inability to service it. There have been a slew of downgrades. We had one come in from CARE Ratings as well recently, just a couple of days back, where they downgraded the company's long-term credit rating to default over its concerns to repay most of its debt.
Well, interesting analysis, Yash.